All right, welcome. We're going to do a reaction stream to the interview from Oz and CCP Ratatti. They talked about some financial and game design things that would relate to a lot of players' current thinking about scarcity and abundancy of materials and underpinning the economy in EVE Online. So we're here with our buddy Caleb. How's it going?
Hey, guys.
Let's make sure all the sound is on and nobody's muted. That's a start. So we're just finishing watching it. I think it's wrapping up. If it hasn't wrapped up already, I'll have a look. I think it just has.
Yeah, they did a few last chance comments and questions and back and forth.
All right. But, what's your primary reaction?
I think I would actually prefer if some of the other people in the room actually gave some of theirs. So
you don't influence the room?
I don't want to influence, right. and I want to know if I'm completely off in how I feel about it.
All right. Well, who do we have in here? Araya, Spod, Dragon. I should put up a list of who's actually in here so people can see some names. Hold the phone 1 second.
Boo.
Oh, and look at that. Somebody jumped on camera with us. All right. Your face is a pass. I mean, it passes a threshold, not... not swipe pass, not swipe pass. All right. Any of you guys in this public room at Talking in Stations have a reaction to the stream that we just saw? Any thoughts?
My initial thought is I really didn't learn a great deal new. It was, they've got some plans, things are going on, but I didn't, nothing earth shattering.
Well, we know that Rorqual is going to become... go back to its previous role as a boosting ship as opposed to a solo mining ship. Same with Orca, kind of command industrial ships, which they kind of should have been the whole time.
I think it's on the box. Isn't that what they're called?
They has been forever, but just the recent incarnation turned them into mining platforms.
Yeah. Well, right. Yeah, more than platforms, they were actually available to solo mine.
Yeah, they made them scale to the point where now initially they were completely overpowered, right? Both yield-wise and the fact that these things are so difficult to kill, right? So you basically got an unkillable mining platform.
Well, they were underpowered originally, right? Like long, long time ago when they were off-grid boosts.
Oh, yeah.
But their change in Rorqual was also due to the moon changes, because you, in the past, you didn't need a mining ship to mine a moon, for you. Once that was removed, you had to replace that. What mines the moon? Oh, now we have a Rorqual. Rorquals can do this new function.
Yeah, and this is what I mean when I've often said that this is about creep, right? It's design creep and lack of rolling back and doing iterations that are now basically... no longer relevant, right? So if you looked at things like the discussion of self-sufficiency, things like discussion of active mining, things like putting actual moons out there that you mine with moon structures instead, all of these things, if you look at these things, if you gave each team one of these roles, these are the solutions you would get. But no one has actually taken the time to look at how Team A, B, C, D, E, F, G actually affect each other. And this is how you got to what we got, right?
All right. Other reactions from people? First reactions, first impressions, important points that came up. And then we'll go through some of the material and what you guys think, particularly.
It was nice to get confirmation that the ESS keys will come from content and not any sort of shop mechanic.
Yeah. Massive troll.
Hey, now. Gosh. From being a disaster. It's just, you know, our disaster.
I was a little offended by that because I was like, aren't markets is an industry content? Like, why isn't...
No, Matterall, that stuff is not content anymore.
No?
Markets is not content anymore. It's been killed. Meta markets are not content anymore. It's been killed. Industry is not really content anymore. It's kind of been killed. group organized mining is not really content anymore. It's been shifted into a few individuals with their multiple accounts, and that's just the nature of the
game. Yeah, that's kind of sad.
You
have a crap ton of orcas, and that's typically the way to go, but time's ticking on that by the sounds of it.
I think I've made a really... Oh, go ahead, Maduro.
Well, just the snobbery of content being... It still rings that bell for me of like content's the only thing that matters. Content is what you do in the game. And then it's usually used as otherwise known as outside undocking and pew-pew-pewing somewhere most of the time with a little bit of exploration maybe or, you know, stuff. But when they talk
reading
content,
way too, I think you guys are reading way too much.
That's
into,
me. That's just me. That's just me reading into that. It's not everybody.
You guys are reading way too much into a sentence that literally just meant they won't be on the Plex store. Like,
right. I'm talking about shorthand, and that's why I'm triggered. And it's just me. It's just emotional. But go ahead.
Yeah, he means content as in stuff, just general stuff.
Yeah,
I think Oz made a really good point. For industry, for new players, in EVE being so complex and so challenging and so unrewarding, right? Because, like his example, if you wanted to build a Rifter, you'd have to get a Rifter BPO, BPC. You have to get all the gun BPO, BPCs. You have to understand how you'd want to fit your Rifter. Like, industry in EVE is not beginner friendly or beginner accessible at all.
It used to be. I'm just going to say that, again, I'm going to go back to the thing that I always mention on any topic like this. The fact that they actually gave us infinite industry slot means that there is no value in building any low-end stuff or further down the pipe with lower margin of profit for the higher margin of profit builders. This is just not a thing anymore. You can't offer yourself as a bulk builder of Tech 1 for a Tech 2 producer because he's just going to do it as himself with an alt.
You're saying there's no opportunity cost with slots anymore?
Exactly. It's like zero. There is no value on slots anymore. There's no value in space anymore because no slots get filled anywhere. So one thing is that they removed, basically they put the queuing system on it to solve the extreme high cost of and value of slots. That was understandable. But when they gave us infinite slots, you pretty much removed the entire value of geography when it comes to actually producing stuff.
It did get easier, though.
One thing he said, I got the sense from this, when we talk as players about famine or poverty, whatever terminology from whatever show, it's always discussed as a phase. I got the sense from him that it's not really a phase. It's the new normal. And that now that he's doing very small tweaks to the economy, did anyone get the sense?
Yeah, that kind of makes sense, but the whole... My reaction to this whole thing was that it was extremely vague and non-committal. There was not even any like grand philosophy things. It's not like the initial one that scarcity breed wars. It's like we didn't get any anything that we can actually use for anything or expect that some things will get fixed or not or in what direction. I got almost way more worried because I don't feel like this is encouraging when it comes to how much of a grasp they have on where they want to take the game. Of course, you shouldn't spill the beans and give us too much information that we can then sit and speculate on. Of course, that would be bad. At least that's one of the things that Matterall hates a lot. But if we don't have any clue on what things they are going to focus on, and I just mentioned infinite slots and how it is completely detrimental to the structure design that you don't have these valuable limitations on them. If they don't have limits, they don't have value. If you have infinite supply, you have zero price finding, right? Regardless of demand, it will always end up in no price. It doesn't cost anything if it's infinite.
There was a couple of, I think when we talked to Mike about that a while back, one of the things he brought up was, yeah, if you went ahead and made definitive slot limits, well, I'll just anchor a bunch more structures. So that has to be molded with, tying certain structure types to certain systems, or some other mechanism. Otherwise, we're just going to end up with a billion more structures out there.
But it's not that difficult. It's about it's not so much about that hard limit, because it's more about, okay, we used to have a queuing system. The queuing system was actually quite good. It didn't solve all our problems, and it, of course, didn't give us the ability to rent to each other. So it was not a final solution of any sort, right? But the point is, you can easily say how many structures are in space right now of a certain type. How much is the average builds in hours used? So the utility. All these things are easy to crunch. So they could easily come up with a model that says an extra large needs to have a maximum of, let's say, 250 slots. A large is 100, and a medium is 50. And then if it becomes a problem, they can put the queuing system back on it. It's not like it's a problem. We just need something that makes it so that not everyone can make everything in 1DQ or G44.
I agree with that. However, I haven't seen a completely elegant solution. I mean, we're all here pretty good at pointing our finger and saying this is broke, but comprehensive solutions are really kind of tough right now because there's so many moving parts we have to take into account.
But it's not. It's really about how much do you need something, right? I remember way back in the day, and I was screaming about this for, I think it was almost 10 years, that the pricing mechanism, the algorithm that was used for office rental was completely ineffective. It didn't do anything. Slots for offices in G44 was always completely full. There was no chance at all to get an office because the speed with which the price increased was just too slow. It never reached the point where anyone wanted to cancel. It was just a non-issue. Office costs, don't care. It's too cheap, right? I begged them for years to make that algorithm way more aggressive. And they tried to tweak it once. It didn't work because it was not enough. Then they went completely overboard, and it actually works. If you look at it now, it works. There has always been at least one or two office slots available in G44 ever since they changed that mechanism, because supply and demand works. And I'm saying, yes, this feels radical that an office slot in GDA right now is about almost 2 billion, I think. But if you can't afford it, you should not have real estate in downtown Manhattan. It's just not some entitlement. You're not entitled to office slots in G44. Why is it not the same with everything else? Why is it not the same with having access to offices in, say, the TTC, right? I don't see why there's something that could break the game if the limitation is too hard, because that will bring price, right? Then the cost actually starts appearing. If the cost appears, there's actual ways of competing. There is no competition if there is no cost.
All right, let's go through some of the answers that Ratatti gave, and then if we have any input. We can have no input, and I'm asking the whole room here. So if you guys don't have anything, we'll just move on. Well, the first what?
I would just like to point out something that I said to Nick yesterday.
Okay.
Everything in the initial Eve online was designed to have these interesting effects and negative feedbacks, right? And I was trying to explain how you have the different mineral types were basically designed so when you're working in space, you have these convenient big roids, right, that makes it very easy and actually more cost-effective to mine pyrite and tritanium. I could show you on actual math that when I was parked in space, I made more money per hour mining tritanium and pyrite than anyone I knew that was chasing around after the bling-bling like some magpie, because this is just opportunity cost on time, right? And because you had that, that means you have this the people that are chasing the high end, and yes, they are getting more nominal value, they're just spending more time on it. Then you had the other way around when we then talk about shipping it, right? When I'm shipping an entire well, back then it was not freighters because they didn't really exist, right? It was industrial ships. That's not an interesting target for a PvP-er. But if you have even a medium-sized ship with the high-end ore, because it's so high in isk per cubic meter, that's a valid target. So you have these counterbalance points where it is more risky to mine the no, to transport the high-end and expensive ore, but it's almost safer to mine it. And it's the other way around when you have to park at the big roids. You have these designs that was thought into the system, and none of this continued in the ideology and philosophy of design from CCP.
All right, so there was a big change in design philosophy. And let's go to the first question that was asked, not the first question that was asked, but the first like meaningful answer that was given about something you might care about. And the question was, this is from Oz on his show, scarcity and redistribution, basically where was it as far as satisfaction? And the answer was, I'm content with how it is going. There are a lot of systems that were bad a year and a half ago. He cites capital proliferation and all the bad things that that brought, basically scaring away your enemy because you had just too much hardware, too many big ships you can intimidate people out of fights and that sort of stuff. And it was just an astonishingly bad situation. He said there were hundreds of titans in Eve, and then at some point it blew into not a few thousand, but many thousands of titans. So that was.
But what he's wrong about is he said that this was not predicted. That's just not true. It was not just. It wasn't even just a little bit
Did
predicted. We knew from the beginning, right? He said that, and we knew. Even when they started to tick up to in the hundreds, this was very much known that this is going to get explosive. And this was one of the reasons why some, in my opinion, stupid suggestions came up with like tokens. So there was a hard limit to how many titans could actually be in the game ever.
Like cores, right? Thing. Cores.
Yeah, but a limited core. So not just cores you had to buy. No, these were actually cores that were generated by...
I thought that was your hero Soundwave suggestion.
It was. He is a hero with the exception of two things. There's
that's
two
one
things
of them.
I will never
PI
ever...
PI is the other one, I bet.
Exactly. PI is the other one. I will never forgive him for those two. The first one was his blunder. It is exactly the same as when Quant talked about ticks. And yeah, there's been many of those foot-in-mouth things and banning leaders and CEOs for something that their foot soldiers are doing illegally. You can't do that. It's just dumb.
All right, so that was his answer. You guys have any thoughts on that? You guys like where the abundance is has gone? Do you like the opposite of abundance?
I'm personally completely on the opposite side of abundance. The Titan super proliferation that he was referring to is just the dramatic example of how out of control it's gotten. And you look at systems with, I mean, the whole idea of when the structures came out, that if you're really good, your alliance might be able to build a keep star. And you look at it now, and it's like they're throwaways almost.
Right. What's your gameplay there, Nick? Is it's small group?
Nowadays, I'm back in high sec, definitely relegated to the small-time industrialist, occasionally shoot something in the face, right. But not
You've
very often.
You've been through that whole nullsec arc of being a warrior in space and all that.
Three times. Yep. Lost absolutely everything three times, so I'm rebuilding for the fourth.
Nice. Staying power, that's what I call that. Anybody else have thoughts on abundancy and where it's at now? Is it?
I mean, there's some problems on the low end right now. Especially with like asteroid belts not spawning in every system at this point, and like ice belts not always spawning. So I understand that, we nerfed all the big mining anomalies to make it so you can only get so much resources out of certain systems. But you go to a lot of systems now and they have empty asteroid belts because they don't spawn at this point.
I've seen quite a few, the respawn rate, I don't know if it's any lower or slower on regular asteroid belts. Ice, I have noticed, and I have no empirical data, just my observation, definitely seems to be tougher to get a hold of in high and low sec. Just the quantity doesn't seem to be as much. That alone, obviously, is going to help, less fuel blocks, less structures.
On the ice thing, they did it was a noted thing that they were reducing the spawn rate. I don't remember the exact details of it, but it's intentionally reduced.
Well, after downtime, some ice belt systems don't spawn any ice belts at all, and they'll be empty for a day or two.
That's by design.
Yeah, we knew that was coming because if you look in the agency, you can basically see where they all spawn at when it's out. I don't think they're still under the 4-hour respawn, but whatever their timer is, it's going to be somewhere constellation or region. It may not be in the same system.
Yeah.
The problem is still back to the original design, right? CCP needs to start thinking of this from an ecosystem and biology point of view way more, because that was originally in the design, right? The fact that they have basically improved and boosted and buffed every tool when it comes to mining over many decades now, that means that in the beginning, you had this design where the asteroid belts and the size of the tools and the speed of the tools means that there was two types of, well, there was three. There was grazers that spend a lot of time to get very little energy, right? That's your low-end stuff. That's your cows just munching away. Then you had your hunters and gatherers almost, right? That took the mid-range stuff that tried to get those Isogen, Mexilon, and Nox yielding things, right? And then you had your actual fruit pickers that just ran in there and took what they needed and then buggered off, right? There's very different potential mortality rates for these three types of prey, right? It is a lot easier to go and kill a cow, but usually these cows are then in groups, and we're back to the, if suddenly it just becomes this giant cow, so you basically have an elephant instead of cows, then you're going to need a lot of lions if you're going to take down an elephant, right? Whereas in the old system, you brought a lot of lions to make sure that the fact that there was a lot of cows, you can get one or two of them, and then you get your prize. It's these predator-prey models that CCP needs to start thinking about again, because these things were in the initial design. But when you're suddenly nomming per cycle 10 times or 20 times what the original mining capabilities were, your game is broken.
Okay. Are you talking about Animal Crossing or Eve? I'm just kidding. I got this. All right.
Hey. Do you remember how old Locked of Volterra is?
Yeah. Are they back?
No, but that whole equation is actually predator-prey dynamics. That is what that is about.
Okay.
On the scarcity subject, I was going to take a different view. Because in one way, yes, it's a huge pain in the ass. Like, there's nothing quite like warping to a belt and seeing that the NPCs have eaten everything and there's literally nothing left for you. But maybe it's masochistic, but I've been taking a bit of enjoyment in the challenge, you know. You're trying to build something and you haven't got Loxium, you haven't got Isogen, you haven't got this, you haven't got that. So you have to now organize you and your buddies to go out and raid the right place to get it. And yeah, that's a whole load of steps and struggle that you didn't have before, but is that not content? Is that not gameplay?
Absolutely. Let me piggyback on that, because some of the most fun, right? We're in agreement. the most fun, the most painful fun I had in EVE Online was in Stain, which is a terrible place. It's like hell in EVE. You go there if you're a bad pilot and you just suffer. We were starving as we were trying to take over space in a nearby system. And I've told this story before, but we were literally cannibalizing every wreck. We were fighting over wrecks to pull equipment out, like reavers, you know, for our ships, because we didn't have a market. And going to the market was always death. So we essentially had to, like, just live off what we killed. And we had to fight over the food or the whatever the carcass was. And if one of our own guys died, there was no guarantee you'd get your stuff back, because people would just pillage you that were your friends. And it was horrible, but amazing time. The adrenaline was real. So the idea of suffering makes you creative. It also creates bonding experiences. The problem happens when you're suffering and everybody else is not. That's why we hate bots, and that's why we hated Abundancy. If everybody's suffering, it's just creative.
And since you're mentioning bots, I have to again give an example of things where the original designs have been completely undermined, right? We usually talk about the thing of all the problems with the age of gun mining. Well, the age of gun mining was not a problem because of the way that items were made when it came to composition and recycle value and stuff like that. On the contrary, the numbers and the designs were actually based on the whole ecosystem ideology of EVE Online. So it worked, except the fact that players figured out how to do these abusive ways of farming the actual rats, right? And when they did that, they could pretty much do, they got the equivalent of a very light version of anomalies, right? Because what you did was you were basically really effectively chaining rats. So you kept the trigger thing, and then you just kept them respawning forever. And at the end of this, you just had a field that was just massive. So you basically had infinite resources back with gun mining. So that was a problem. Also because then you had the added benefit of, well, now these things are actually naturally compressed. So they're better than ore, right? And then we started down the whole arms race of compression mechanics and calculating whether or not something was worth refining at the location or shipping as an export good. So there was just so many things that went wrong, but this was not because of the composites of the item. So something like tyrosite and removing minerals from pretty much every drop, all these things are basically undermining the fundamental economy of what is common and what is rare, which then breaks the loot tables, which then breaks the whole import-export stuff. And then they removed the ability to have utility on meta modules, so you couldn't use them in invention anymore. So they also flattened that. So you just they just kept dumbing, well, it's not fair to dumb it down. They just made it more streamlined and solved problems that then caused more problems.
So why are you telling me all this? Like, what?
Because they need to go back.
What's your point?
They simply need to go back and look at what was the intent of the original design from an ecosystem and economy perspective, and why was it done like that? And all the things that they have fixed in ways that break something else. The best example was when we just talked about industry slots, because it was a problem, right? We had the exact opposite. We had something that was akin to a worse famine or scarcity of industry slots than the current mineral scarcity. That was how horrible it was. Getting a research slot or getting a building slot in a meaningful place was pretty much impossible. But the solution was infinity. Mm-hmm. That's going the other way.
This might be a longer conversation about convenience in games, because it sounds like your complaint is every time they try to make the game more convenient, they make it worse.
Well, not really, because many things should be convenient, I think. It's just that they solved very hard conveniency problems with very hard either abundance problem or the other way around, where they're basically shutting something off.
All right.
Structures is basically a massively convenience benefit, right? Even if they had limited slots, because you can sell them to each other. And if you need more infrastructure, you can expand stuff in your system. And you don't have to use NPC slots, because you, when you use NPC, you should really have the requirements of things like standing, at least you used to. But they didn't really do anything like that.
Okay, so what he says, this is CCP Ratatti there at the end, is that there's one more big change coming soon. It's not a bad change, but it's drastic. It's going to change the landscape for many. What do you guys think it is?
Is this the one that we've been told that Caleb won't like?
Well, he doesn't like many changes unless they're... That's not true. He likes changes. What do you guys think it is?
Like, I can't remember where or how or when, but I know I've heard implications of a hint, of a legend, of a rumor of it being market-related.
Well, it's going to affect
a lot of people. I know I've smelt that somewhere. And who is not affected by the market, ultimately? Or something, it's not necessarily the market, but contracts, something in that remit of things.
All right. So,
do you think someone has actually been appointed to create futures so we can retroactively fix Hilmer's articles?
So he's thinking that will age well. He's talking about something not in the game, hoping that developers make it so it's in the game. So in 6 months, that article will actually be accurate.
Well, I think it sounds to me like they might actually not be putting this where I would want it, which is on the moon mining. It sounds like they're going to put it maybe somewhere in multipliers and system buffs or something like that. Maybe even modules that go into space. It sounds like it might be agency like that. So you kind of change the consistency of your space, which I think, again, is would be really bad, because then it just becomes one of those horrible things like industry indexes and ADMs, which basically do the exact opposite of what they should do.
I mean, CCP has been hinting for years that you're going to be able to like control the weather in your nullsec space, right?
No.
Yeah, weather control.
I haven't heard that. I've heard weather, but not control. Maybe.
It was part of the cycles. They keep on mentioning there needs to be an ecosystem, and then you need to be able to master your ecosystem. It was one of the presentations they had in Vegas when they had the Las Vegas.
I think it's to survive it, so that the weather doesn't affect you as much as it affects everybody else in the area. That sort of a thing, maybe. Because they were talking that in terms of cloak, you know, a cloak
maybe,
ship,
yeah.
You'd be able to. I don't know. Maybe that's what it was. I think when they talked in terms of being able to control the environment, they were talking about pollution. And the consequences of polluting your area would mean that you couldn't get as much out of it. Therefore, you would want to go and pollute somebody else's area, put the byproducts there.
Yeah, and again, pollution is actually one of those things that we've had in the game in the past. It looked like they really wanted to do something with it, but they never got around to actually doing it. Because we had these things like trash, right? We had these things like radioactive waste and things like that. These things existed. It just, they didn't do anything. And I'm pretty sure that they had hopes that at some point they could maybe do something with these items. The amount of things that CCP have in this game that looked like it was intended for something that then never actually appeared, that's a big number.
All right. Should we move on to another one? You got anything else on abundancy and where it's at, where it should have been? Can we just say, like, as Nick was saying earlier, and probably CCP Ratatti saw this in the stats, that having hundreds of Titans die and not having it destroy a war, like, you know, make that completely fall apart, was a sign of just how broken abundancy was when it was here.
Yeah, well, my takeaway is that he didn't double down on the fact that we're not really... Everyone is doing a little bit of an impersonation of Chicken Little these days and screaming the sky is falling. I think the effects of the war means that the data that we're getting is not really representing what the changes have actually done, because we've not really worked in an environment with these changes where we were at peace, right? So I don't think you can say that it's as bad as people claim, and I think Ratatti didn't want to really comment on it because he knows that the data right now doesn't really say anything, because at least when it comes to things like mining, the mining numbers are just massively down, right?
Well, they said they were going to fix mining. There was going to be some adjustments to mining. I think that's when the Roracle and the Orca came up in conversation, about fixing those as boosters.
Yeah, and that's more about mortality, right? That's about mortality rates and the fact that the Roracles and Orcas...
It sounded like they were going to move them into a boosting role, so yeah. Maybe...
Because that will bring more ships out in the fields, right? Again, this is back to getting cows to actually be herds again.
Well, it would also raise APM for mining, because you have to pay a lot more attention to your mining barges than you do a Roracle that you see on a spud rock for 20 minutes, right? You got to be moving your ore back and forth. There's a lot more to do.
Yeah.
And what does that do to the mineral price index if most of the mining right now is Orca mining in high sec, and they remove that as a role and it goes to active ships? What do we actually see in terms of mineral price index? Will it continue to skyrocket?
No, it will slow down, but still increase because until we get the population of workers back, so the man hours and the actual cycles back in space, which I think will take some time because we lost a lot of them, and a lot of the universe was fed by multi-boxing and automation instead of.
But that's what it is now. If you have a person that's running 10, 12 Orcas, how many Hulks can they run at the same time? If Orcas lose their mining ability,
but you probably go down to one or two Orcas and then like 5 to 10 mining barges, and that would probably be near the limit of what a person can do by themselves.
And that will pressure the yield, and it will increase the mortality rate. So there's going to be a lot more soft targets in space again. So hunting will actually be meaningful again.
Well, also after they change the Orca and the Rokel back into a boosting ship, they're going to reintroduce more minerals back into the market, right? Because they drastically reduced the size of asteroids in the market to like stop all this. So once they fix this balance between barges and command ships, they're going to need to reintroduce volume of minerals to the environment.
Yeah, and I think one of the important things that I would do, maybe not in an instant, but at least slowly, is slowly try to turn down the yield per cycle, but turn up the size of the actual available minerals in space. Because I've always been of the opinion that the limitation should be in stages, right? And you want these things to be in space as long as possible. This is also why the worst change they ever did to the game, and I don't think they understand how big it was, is making it possible for freighters to actually scoop stuff from space. Because back in the day, when you didn't have that, you could not use these things to take big hauls of, say, compressed ore or things like
that.
That
was a huge change, and nobody really talked about it much. It was a game changer for hauling ore.
Basically, the way to maybe get into the middle ground would be to say that big ships with the big hauls can only scoop actual player built containers, right? That would be fair. So when they drop, that's fine. But when it's cans in space, that is the same as trying to suck gas, pick up gas. It's like you should not be able to do that. That was the role of the smaller ships, which meant that there was like 5-10 people working with haulers, and then this has just been replaced by one freighter.
It took away a job, right? There used to be a guy that would haul, and that was a thing that somebody could do with not a lot of training and even not a lot of practice. It literally just haul the stuff, sit out there with the miners, and
it was what noobs did, right?
Yeah,
they were first introduced to doing things like hauling, and then they might be put on, say, a scouting group that went from belt to belt and both cleaned out some of the stupid NPCs if they were being a little bit of a problem. Mm-hmm. And they potentially scouted for players that could come in and harass or were already in those belts working, right? Mm-hmm. So there was just a whole different ecosystem when it comes to behavior. And this was removed with one change, making the freighter capable of scooping in space.
Right. All right. So the other thing that Ratatti said was, where is that? Given the question, like, you know, where would you rate the economy now from A to B or something?
Yeah, he said, Oz said that he was not expecting to see the carrot or the end of the famine period until it was in the health area of being rated A or even AAA. Again, I won't agree with that because I think that would be a mistake.
Yeah, you got it wrong. So Ratatti says it's about a D right now, or it's a C.
It's a C, and Oz said he did not expect it until it was A or AAA. I completely said was what was said on that show.
Yeah, but then Ratatti countered that and said, no, it doesn't have to be at an A before we start introducing that.
Yeah, exactly, which is the same reply. That's what I mean. I would not hope that the famine continues, and I don't think it does. So he confirmed we are going to get some of these things put back in before it starts hurting even more. But again, it sounds like it's so far out in the future that I'm a little bit worried of on what side of the war it's going to land, because I think it almost needs to come before the war ends. Otherwise, we might be in trouble.
I said something else about not using a sledgehammer, but using a scalpel. What do you guys think of that analogy? And what do you think he meant?
I hope he means
some of the changes have been very sledgehammery, haven't they?
Yeah.
I kind of feel like I've been smacked by one or twice at this point.
I think a blackout kind of scenario would be a sledgehammer, and everything since has been scalpel. So you mess with the Sino, you don't mess with the ability to see local.
Well, remember them removing all the ore from the ore anomalies with a stealth patch. It was not an announced, it wasn't in the patch notes. It was just one day we logged in and ore anomalies have drastically less minerals in them.
Well, and let's be fair. When I thought that they were bringing scarcity, I thought that they were turning down the availability. I didn't think that they were going to completely make it massively exclusive in different areas at this level. And I definitely didn't think that they were going to nerf it to the point that they did. I've been asking for scarcity because I know that it's needed, but they pretty much brought famine, right? This was a famine. You can see this on how difficult it is for organizations to actually supply their stuff.
Real quick, I want to thank Oz for having the interview. This is a reaction stream to the interview that Oz had. Welcome to you Oz fans that just joined us. We're going through some of the questions that were asked, and we have an open hall here at Talking In Station, so you're welcome to join us in our public channel.
I got the impression that the ore changes were the sledgehammer, and then that they have identified, they've added the dynamic bounty system, I think, is the scalpel he was talking about. The fact that they can just slowly adjust one little number to change the percentages. I read something recently that they found the actual code that governs asteroid belt respawning.
2 years ago.
Was that 2 years ago? Yeah.
Two years ago.
So I think they're going to be able to use that with the dynamic bounty system and be able to do, you know, to slowly adjust minerals and ores in a dynamic way.
And the problem in Eve is that everything is tied to everything. So when you just mentioned the fact that they found the ore code and how it actually respawns and all that stuff and how it ties into downtime, then you start having the requirement of discussing downtime, right? Because if it's tied to downtime, do they then take it out and no longer tie it to downtime at all and then make it something that is over time a little bit like anomalies? Or do they still leave it so there's some sort of change or benefit from the other side of downtime? And what about the fact that they have promised that at some point they could almost get rid of downtime completely? And I have mentioned that I think we should have a different time increment, because the fact that it's at the same time every day means that people can actually game it and abuse it from a time zone perspective. And then you start talking about, well, are you gaming it to get access to roids, or are you gaming it to abuse, basically the gong when you're talking about structure bashing? There's so many things that tie into each other when you're talking Eve, right? Because if they make one change, like say, if it was a 3 day between each downtime, can you imagine doing structure fights? It's like, oh my God, what? Big fights can actually last 3 days?
I saw a suggestion that for dealing with how super capital ships typically get moved just before downtime, if you need to be sneaky, do have downtime be a random point during some window of 15 minutes or so.
Well, that's again because you kind of have that gong thing to help you if you get caught, right?
Yes, it's a similar idea.
Yeah, and this is why all these things always tie into each other. This is the horror of being a CCP dev. And this is why I don't like poo-pooing on them and calling them complete idiots. Because, again, when you're sitting with one thing, you might overlook or forget that, oh, this actually, if I pull this string, it actually does this. And, oh, if I do this code thing that changes standing, all the fucking pauses in the universe is going to be potentially shooting at themselves.
All right. CCP signal in the audience there says, nobody found the Oracle code. It's a myth. There is no spoon.
On that topic, does anybody actually know for reals, 100% true, how on earth do belts work? Because it's one of those things that is shrouded with mystery and nobody really has ever written anything that I can find, at least, of how do they respawn?
I thought they used to respawn.
They respawn at downtime.
At downtime.
But yeah. But yes, but no. They respawn a bit. But what defines a bit?
How it was harvested. What was in it before. So last downtime. Mm. And what's in it when downtime hit. And then it comes back. It's basically some sort of replenishing mechanism. There was a few articles that tried to actually reverse engineer it back in the day, but I don't think anyone's actually come up with the correct numbers.
Hmm. Okay, so something else here. So Sawyer 83 says it's based on how much was mined. So maybe that's along the right lines. Or maybe it's a Children of Light mystery that nobody will ever figure out.
Spot, you might be able to figure it out, because I think someone said that it was similar to those algorithms with the flowers, with how they are next to each other and how they mix, and how if there's space, then it creates a flower, but it's going to be sized on the ones that are next to it. I think it's one of those weird algorithms, because those things were very popular back in the day when the game was designed.
CCP signal, I don't know if it's definitive. It's ambiguous enough to be definitive. It's just a replenishing mechanism at downtime. So
I would guess it's probably just a case of X percent of the total cap of that belt is added per downtime. And if you mine some of that, you mine some of that. Doesn't necessarily affect it in that sense.
Yeah. All right. So
the reason why I don't accept his just, because people have been trying to reverse engineer it since forever and no one has been able to figure it out. So I don't think it's
Children of Light's not just figured out yet either. It's
been around. That's true. But when it comes to someone that can optimize their spreadsheet and their mining capability, trust me, the incentive is big.
Are you pitting RP nerds against mining nerds?
That's not even a battle. If you're talking about the degree of depth that someone will go through, and you pit a lore nerd against an Excel sheet warrior, the Excel warrior wins every time.
All right, let's talk stockpiles, right? Because one of the things that was asked, are the stockpiles gone to your satisfaction, basically? Are they going as fast? And his answer was, the war helped for sure. He was taken aback by CCP. Ratatti was taken aback by the proliferation. It was crazy how many Titans and Supers were built. That's when he says they used to have hundreds and then all of a sudden they had thousands. He didn't remember when it was that changed, but Tritanium came into the game in huge amounts.
He made it sound as if there was suddenly some magical swords. I'm pretty sure the magical swords was anomalies.
Anomalies and Rorquals.
Yep.
Right, the perfect storm. Skill point injectors, Rorquals, and anomalies all at once. They've got Holy Trinity of infinite resources.
So let me explain this a little bit. In 2014, there was a notice that there was going to be new sovereignty. Dominion was going to change. And so NullSec decided they were going to weigh in on this. And they called for a more dense population. Place. They cited that a lot of systems were empty and it didn't reward people for having space. And this was called the Null Deal, put together by Goon Swarm and signed on by people like NC. Triumvirate and other groups. Basically, Null leaders all said, we want population density. And
really just gave us the answer, by the way. And the big number of increase when it comes to, I think it was Tritanium was Spot back then.
Great. So, see, Spot, it's your fault. All this is you.
It's always Spot's fault.
So that was the pressure from players. 6 months later, you had an adjustment to sovereignty that was to be able to upgrade your space. So you could have really cheap and terrible space, and you could actually upgrade it through ADMs. And then about a year after that came the rebalance to Rorquals. And at that point, you had kind of a deadly combination of the ability to mine a lot and the ability to create mine fields abundance of them, those two things together, plus the protection of the things, the products of the mining, created a cycle.
And that's, yeah, it was military guarded vertical farms, infinite vertical farms. But again, in that age, it made sense because there was beginning to be a, it was not just a bottleneck. It was like a massive bottleneck. It was horrible. The amount of titanium and pyrite that you had to export because you couldn't really easily source it in Null was really a problem. And you saw this every single time there was big fights and things like that. It was, and this whole thing of compressing with 420 guns, and it's like 425 because it was not cannabis. Anyways, the point is that was the solution, right, for every compression thing, to build these and then take the hit. And it's like all of this was just bad.
It just keeps going on and on with that analogy.
Yeah, that was the 425 millimeter guns that were the most efficient for M3 to have. So you just build those and reprocess them.
Yeah,
you ship those out,
and that was just bad design, right? And there was a need for a change of some sort.
And now we can just directly compress the ore.
Well, if you think about it, because we did have the issues with slots and industry in HiSec back then, it was not efficient, it was not good, and it didn't actually make sense because. That was why we wanted structures, right? Because then we could kind of say, okay, then fine. We don't let's not export all of it. Let's just export the stuff into Null that we need for the stuff that cannot actually be built in HiSec, but the rest HiSec can keep. So they can build all the T1 hulls and all the modules and all that stuff. They can have that market. That's fine. We're going to build that up ourselves and have our parsers and our alts and all that stuff. But the point is that the infrastructure back then didn't work for that. It was not good for that. And there was no player-to-player business options, even though so many people wanted to rent out their slots on their parsers for research. It was pretty much a hassle. You had to do it trust-based. I had to give you my original blueprint and hope that you were actually going to give it back to me. It was just dumb. Then some did the alt where you could join with your character and have some sort of... It was a mess. So structures solved all of that, but then they just brought in a whole new range of stupid problems, like the price, the price tags on services in those structures are either nothing because they're infinite, or they're a mess, like the percentage of a percent that makes it look like you're stealing from someone.
All right. Wanted to just add a few more things to this, and that was that he did see that. He said this was interesting. I thought this was very interesting and very telling, and that was, once we get the proliferation down, the stockpiles, we still have the N+1 problem. What do you guys think of that? Is that a key to anything in the future?
I'm curious to why it's phrased as a problem. N+1 has been a feature of conflict in this game for almost the entire life of the game.
I'm pretty sure it is in real life too.
Yeah. Yeah, the only limiter of N+1 in real life is geography, right?
Yeah.
I think you're just trying to make the... Sorry, go on.
There's culture. There's geography. There's religion. There's all kinds of things that divide people.
In my previous corp, the CEO announced the birth of his child by pigging out that he applied N+1 to real life.
Good one.
I mean, there are other MMOs that have such power creep. When you get to max level, you press one button and you can kill scores of players that aren't at max level with best in slot gear. But that's not EVE.
And I've heard
that way one person can go against 30 of light ships and say, well, I have purple mods. I'm going to click F1. You're all going to die.
Aurea, when I hear that's not EVE, I hear that's not American. You ever hear a Canadian say that's not Canadian?
Aren't we about to evolve to use F2?
A goon swarm in the Imperium is inside joke there, I guess.
I just thought it was a reminder that while on the one hand you have, you know, the capital, super capital proliferation, and the other side of the equation is always N+1. He did seem very happy about the new metas, the battleship metas and stuff, those kind of doctrines. You know, but even without super capitals, if everyone's in battleships again, you're still going to have N+1.
And again, it's not really his table. If we're talking about how to fix that, that's not really his responsibility. His responsibility is to look at the mortality rate, take that piece of paper, go over and show it to Rise and say, I suspect these three ships seem to have problems because they never die. And these four ships seem to die all the time. Is there a good reason for this? And is it something that you have your eyeballs on? And could you please figure out how to change this a little bit? Or he can go in and say, I want this ship to die more, please.
Well, we don't know how they work, right? They're their own company, but...
No, I'm saying that to evolve the prey and the predators is Rise's table. Whether or not the mortality rate is correct, that is the ecosystem's team.
Well, it does seem like we're slowly inching towards some sort of circular escalation path where you bring subcapitals and then you escalate to capitals to beat the subcapitals, and then you escalate the supercapitals to kill the capitals, and then maybe if we can get subcapitals to kill the supercapitals, we could have a circular escalation route, right? And that would kind of help the N+1 problem.
Exactly, and if it can be made granular because of things like formations and new attack options in space, so new types of weaponry, this would be even better. Then we can really get some of the things we need to at least slow down this blob and bait ball versus bait ball. Everyone is there from start of the game. That's not a war, right?
Well, I thought it was interesting. You said that we still have the N+1 problem, whether it's his purview or not. It was interesting that he recognized that was still something that would always be a problem, it looked like. And I don't think he had an answer for that. But next question from Oz was, are you clear on what caused that spike, the hockey stick, they called it? And this is where it goes into the tritanium and all that stuff. So we'll skip that. We talked about that. Dynamic resources distribution going forward. What do you guys think of the... Because we know scarcity has three chapters to it. We'll call it chapters. The first one is to just basically stop certain amount of minerals being distributed. The second one is to change the geography of where those are. They've done those two. The third one is, what is it? Dynamic systems.
Yeah, dynamic systems is such a huge topic, and I just think that when it comes to CCP, I feel like they are a little bit creating too much work for themselves. Instead of trying to force some sort of, I don't know, randomizer or stuff like that, you don't need that. You only need three player-sensitive variables involved in anything that you're doing, right? If you have that, then it will automatically and naturally move towards some sort of either explosive exponential thing, a completely exponential diminishing thing, or a completely volatile chaotic system. This is well known. It's the three pendulum thing. If you have three variables in these things, they can become completely impossible to predict. That means that we as players can't game them. This is exactly what we need when we're talking things that are currently extremely static. So things like loot tables. This is why I keep mentioning the loot fairy and figuring out how to tie it to things that might actually be dynamic enough, so sensitive to player activity, then it's a mess and you can't put it on a spreadsheet.
All right, looking at Omeka Gold's comments out there, Villy is out there as well. So a CCP signal, those are all key people you might want to see what they have to say. Omeka Gold says CCP can emphasize investment over skill. He's talking about the N+1 thing that we're past. Sorry.
Yeah, unfortunately, N+1 is like a big can of worms in EVE Online. As soon as you mention we get endless debate.
They seem to have solved it in Albion Online, didn't they?
No,
it's a huge problem there still.
I thought they have really good low small gang environment there.
I'm not sure if you want me to go into the mechanics of how they tried to tackle N+1. It's quite complicated.
We should invite Grace, formerly known as CCP Grayscale, to come and tell us about it himself.
But the quick note is the larger group you are in, you get a stacking debuff depending on the size of your group. So the way the players work around this is they get into a officially unaffiliated group that's still your friend. They just show up as enemies on the map, and that group will go around without this debuff and bomb into the other groups and do more damage. So it just takes more coordination between groups.
Right. Okay. Hey, you need to stop typing or use push to talk. Otherwise, I feel like you're chewing on my shoe.
No, it's just I really don't like when people use Albion as a comparison, because yes, Albion is great and it's got a lot of DNA from EVE Online. It's just when we're talking scales and complexity and things like that, it's just so not comparable. So even though they've done some very cute and very brilliant things in there, and some of the things are really maybe better balanced for those scales, you can't apply this backwards. That would be not just would it be incestuous, it would just be wrong. So let's not talk about Albion to help find solutions to Eve.
Okay, fine.
That's my opinion.
Okay,
you're allowed.
Dynamic systems, closing that topic. We'll skip around here, but the other one that I thought was interesting was, and they've asked this question many times in the past, but it's nice to hear it refreshed, and that was, does CCP manage Plex? Do they want it to land at a certain point, and do they influence it either by giving stuff out as login rewards or as selling it as packs and that sort of stuff?
No, they stopped that. They did it two times historically, I think, with Dr. Aok, because he was trying to make sure that it didn't run crazy back in the day. Then the Praxis was basically shelved, even though he was still at the helm, so he still had it as an ultimate button he could push, basically using banned Plex and banned ISK if it was needed to fix the economy. So either buy or sell Plex to fix the price. Again, it has not happened. So in-game, they haven't manipulated it. So that leaves maybe out of game. They could have had some strategies of saying, oh, we need now a bit of a drop in price, so we should have a big sale. But the sales seem to come in cycles that does not have any relation to any plan or speculation. They might have said, let's start making some more of these deals because they're popular, they're selling,
yeah,
and they actually make it easier to pay with ISK in-game as well. So it's got a double positive effect. So they might have had a meeting like that, but that would have just been a completely agenda change where it's longer lasting, and it's a longer lasting plan.
They're different departments, if you think about it, right? Like, game development doesn't care what the business side is doing, and the business side doesn't know what's going on in the game and where the development is. So when they cycle through sales, they're looking at statistics, spreadsheets, seasonality. When's the good time in the real world to put a sale on? Right after Thanksgiving, all that kind of stuff. That's when those choices are made. They might be completely decoupled from what's going on in the game. And sometimes it looks suspicious. Yeah.
But that's because let's just give them a little bit of a gold star here, right? Because if the actual business group has been developing these things better and hitting better compositions of products and actually being better at actually promoting them market-wise with ads and visuals and all these things, and getting them right when it comes to seasonality, actually selling when they know that people are willing to actually sell, to actually buy these things, that might actually be why you're seeing this, because they've just gotten better. And maybe also the player base has matured or evolved a little bit to be more willing to actually use their credit card.
We have a couple.
If you look at the revenues that have been growing quite a lot lately,
mm-hmm.
That might be the solution, right? So you would expect, if CCP is getting more money, since the majority of that economy is Plex-driven, that will mean that more people have actually bought Plex. That means more Plex are going to come into the game. That means the supply goes up, and if the demand stays the same, the price goes down. That's how markets work. Sorry.
A couple of pieces of good news. One is I found Caleb's volume dial, and I turned him down. So that
that's an important dial.
We're the same. We should be closer to the same. Another thing is Olmeca Gold just jumped in channel with us. How's it going, Olmeca?
Hey, guys. Can you hear me you hear me fine?
Yeah, I can hear you just fine. Thanks.
All right.
Couple things. One is, before you start, I'm sad to see you here because I know you were winning Eve. And I don't want to see you lose.
No, I just love the ecosystem talks.
So. Okay, good.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
My baby is due in a week or so. I'm definitely.
Congratulations.
Awesome.
Well, thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
There's N plus one in action.
And then you need to make sure you have an alpha account ready for him, so he's going to have his orca ready when he can actually fly it.
He is going to be the heir of my 80 accounts, so we don't have an issue of accounts.
And Shane Bushing Young.
All right, what'd you think, Olenka?
When I went to Iceland, I was super surprised. I asked one of the very first questions I asked was like, do you guys have like an ideal price point for Plex? Did you ever research this? I would think like CCP, this would be super important to CCP, and it would be like they would have strict answers to this. And they don't. They just leave it to supply and demand. That's kind of interesting. When I was asking those questions, it was in the spirit of like the proliferation era, where I kind of thought so many butter alts and like Rorqual alts and like PVE alts in general driving the prices up was kind of bad, because they also inflate the ISK, and then people who actually need Plex to fund their PvP and such, it would be, or to fund their people who don't have the real money and then who want to have the Plex to pay for the game, it was less accessible to them because it was more expensive. At the other side, of course, there is the issue of if Plex becomes too cheap, then it's not going to be valuable. So it was an interesting topic for me to ask CCP and have no answer at all.
Yeah, their answer was Plex is as valuable as players want to make it. He did say something that was interesting, though. I got to thinking about this. It says their security measures have knocked out so many bots, because bots really use Plex all the time, that the a sign that they're doing well against bots is that the price goes down, because demand pressure on Plex goes down. You don't need all those Plex for all those alt accounts that are doing all the botting. And I thought, so after every time they do a giant wipeout of 2,000 bots, I should sell all my Plex because it's going to go down in price.
Or you should get ready to buy.
Well, you want to wait till it hits bottom and starts bouncing up. That's when you usually buy.
I mean, it's typically a game of supply and demand, but if there is one opinion about Plex price, I think it shouldn't increase at the cost of ISK pumping into the game. Because, okay, if the price of Plex increases, then it's going to be more lucrative for players who want to buy Plex and sell it for real in-game money. But then if in-game money is less valuable because there's so many bots, and things are more expensive in general as well or something, then it's going to have equal value. So the bots just increase the Plex price for no benefit, basically. So I think, and if we follow the RMT values of ISK, they're doing a good job against bots.
One thing I found interesting, where he said that players selling Plex are not price sensitive. So it doesn't matter if you get 500 million ISK for your Plex or if it's a billion ISK, people buy Plex for real cash and they sell it, irregardless. The people buying Plex from the in-game market are obviously a little bit more price sensitive, but not the people selling. Which I just thought was, obviously he has some data to back that up, and I just thought it was very interesting.
That is interesting. I kind of thought that too.
I mean, I guess one of the coolest things about Plex is it's our version of gold. So you could debate that Plex's value never changed, just the buying power of ISK goes up and down, and that reflects onto Plex, right?
Yeah. Well, it's a sign of the value of labor in the game.
Financially, it's a stockpile game, right? The amount of Plex that's in the system now is not necessarily going down. That means that the only thing that changes is who gets first to market to sell. This is where you get the price fluctuation. You're never going to see an actual stockpile reduction in a meaningful way. It's really about catching up, and it's when do people then want to either buy or sell with real money, right? So these things are a little bit different than your normal economy and resources in EVE Online, and the utility remains the same unless there's a change in population, right? So unless there's new players or new alt accounts being spun up, you will not change the demand on Plex. It's pretty much locked. And when it comes to demand of ISK, that's also very similar. It's only sensitive to things like massive sinks out of the game, right?
Well, you can also argue that if our population is proportional to people who use Plex, people who buy Plex, even as you get new players, those new players, some of them will buy Plex to sell on the market, and some of them will buy off the market to pay for their subscriptions. And if that proportionality doesn't change, it's going to stay relatively
the same. One can say that if there is an influx of new players, so the portion of new players increases compared to old veteran players, and one can argue that happened last year, then there will be more people who are buying Plex from CCP and less people buying from market, because new players won't make as much money, basically, to afford ISK, right?
You're correct. Like, telling a new player to pay for their subscription with ISK is kind of a noob trap, right? So,
but that's a mess. Then you're talking about the two different sides of the thing, and they are not even, they're only indirectly related. You have to talk about one side of the Plex market at a time, the in-game one and the out-of-game one. If you start talking about both of them, it becomes a little bit crypto to actually figure out exactly what's going on, because then you have to look at segments and their willingness to spend or not spend money, as was just mentioned. This is a very difficult thing to predict.
Well, I don't know. I would say new players compared to old players, they buy more Plex from CCP, and old players buy more Plex from the market, because old players have more ISK and have more means to make ISK. So I don't know. I mean, that would be my prediction, but I didn't see any statistics.
We don't know. And again, when we're then talking about, doesn't that get offset by, it's the old players that are the whales, right? So those old whales will basically proportionally represent more of those other players. It's basically them distributing their real money to their friends.
I don't know. I've seen some. Lately, we've seen, and actually in the past, we've seen some new bro whales, right? You got the guy that bought the entire Super Capital fleet for Red Overlord. Miss Rabbit.
When you have people like Miss Rabbit, when you have people like the Aluminum Tycoon and stuff like that, that's a veteran player by category that's putting cash into the game. And then if he has 100 people that are proportionally not putting cash into the game, as Olmeca is mentioning, the ones that want to just use ISK, well, they're his clients. So that is one-to-one, the same as the fraction of new player composition, right? Two new players change. How much are they willing to spend? And I'm saying that veterans have more money, they have a deeper investment in the game, so they are more prone to the sunken ISK, sunken cost fallacy. That means they're also more likely to want to swap that credit card if they do not have the time.
All right. We're joined by Oz, who did the actual interview with CCP Ratatti. Welcome. Oz, did you have a favorite question that you asked?
Oh, I just came in to lurk, but sure.
Well, I'm dragging you
turn
out.
Turn the tables. No, I mean, the Plex that you're discussing right now is a very pressing issue. I don't know if if they would have admitted to it, if they were managing it, but I do believe that they aren't managing it, at least not actively anymore. He was also very, very clear on the fact that they are not being impacted at all by Pearl Abyss. And so I do believe that at his level, I think at Hilmar's level, of course, there's going to be some sort of financial reporting where they're going to be steering his KPIs in a certain direction for sure. And that's, in the end, there's no way that is not going to impact the game in one way or the other. But it's good to know that on the level of Ratatti, it's more or less a you know, a net positive impact, and that's something that that I really liked about the interview.
Yeah, Billy's in here too now. Yeah, it was a good interview. Thanks for doing that for everybody and telling us about it. It was good to watch. Went about
that you can see in the actual report that you covered with Noisy and Dirk that it's very much a hands-off attitude when it comes from Pearl Abyss.
Yeah, it was confirmed.
CCP runs that boat all by themselves, and as long as there is no hey, where's the check, I'm pretty sure that PA is completely just going to ignore them. Just do your thing. We don't know what is in that weird black box up there in Iceland, but if you keep sending the check on the revenues, it's fine. You keep going.
You also have to keep localizing in Asian languages.
Question.
Yeah, that was one of the goals, right? One of the requirements that they want for the common quarters.
Question from the audience here. Burning Beard says, regarding the interview, since I missed it, was it mentioned that CCP's intended changes with the market tax increases are being basically sidestepped by letting Monopoly Anchor, unlike unkillable Keepstars and HiSec? I think he's talking about you, Billy.
I wish they were unkillable, I can assure you.
Yeah. Well, HiSec is different than we just saw some action in LowSec where you had a Keepstar that was destroyed. But when it came to your HiSec Keepstar, looks like the perpetrators were tripped up quickly.
Their War HQ structure didn't even wasn't even fueled, so it was just one timer.
Well, maybe it was just a meme trick anyway. But
yeah, it definitely was.
They were testing the response. They were, you know, trying to identify if the TTTC, the Tranquility Trading Consortium, you know, was still unified together in defense of the HiSec, since we ignored the LowSec. We sent a very clear message that HiSec was not going to be treated as the same as LowSec. And they, you know, they promptly had Ward X from 250,000 people. And, you know, their war structure died one day and 12 hours later. And the war ended.
To answer the question on the chat, I think I remember Ratatti saying, like, severely questioning the decision, initial decision to let Keepstars and HiSec. But now that it's there, I don't think they will remove it forcibly. So
I think we kind of forget when the TTC went down the first time just how much conflict there was over that structure, right? There were daily fleets fighting on that Keepstar and perimeter.
Yeah,
but they realize the profit like exponentially grows if you don't fight and just share the profit.
they sued for peace and became rich, everybody.
And it doesn't exponentially grow, but it remains steady.
Yeah, it's game design. There's nothing to blame, or I don't know. It's a monopoly, but it's by game design, so people's decisions are.
A Keepstar in HiSec seems more natural than a Keepstar in deep space, right? Like, just seems. Quite. Yeah.
It's a lot better. I just like the picture I saw in my head was Vili hugging his baby Jita, saying, "No touch baby Jita."
I don't want
to. Honestly, okay. I don't know why. I mean, to me, the problem is the like the broker's fee or whatever, the tax difference between the MPC and the Keepstars in HiSec. So maybe it's okay for these structures to exist. It's just I don't know why CCP is giving away so much of the
offshoring. Yeah.
Yeah.
The reality is if you don't have the offshoring component, then there's no incentive to use structures in HiSec that are not NPC structures, and nobody would, right? People are always going to choose as a market, yeah. But
yeah,
like, you know, if you want people to have markets in HiSec, then this is how you do it. And obviously, you know, we're currently fighting a battle over security versus money making with Perimeter, where, you know, Gita44 is the more secure location. Your stuff in Gita44 will never be attacked. It will never go to asset safety. It will never be under threat. But you sacrifice that percentage of revenue, and offshoring obviously kind of is the best of both worlds for people. But it's not a perfect world either.
There's still an incentive. If the tax rates were the same, then you would maybe trade in your own structure to give the money to your own entity instead of the NPCs. But apart from that, you're right. But maybe I just don't know. Because when I look at Eve, I look at like rewards in Eve. Everything to me exists for like some kind of reason. And I don't know the reason why. I don't think the money that CCP is giving away to TTT by game design isn't worth it. It's not worth the content that's emerging from it, you know? We always talk about conflict drivers and rewards, and it's not a good conflict driver to me.
Story this week that it's actually creating content, so you're completely wrong. And the offshoring is, as Willy said, it is sadly the only incentive to move from NPC to player-owned structure services. And that's a design problem from CCP's side. But other than that, if that's the only thing we get right now, it's not just good, it's needed.
I don't want to jump ahead here, but you know, they did talk about dynamic systems and the dynamic system of the market fees, which I thought was really interesting and could be very, very interesting in helping create lesser trade hubs.
But this is trademarking that.
All of their cost thing in the game right now is a little bit off. I know that Willy is aware that one of the horrible ones is the pricing on structure services when it comes to industry, where the visuals of what it looks like the cost is and the actual real cost is a complete mess because people think that you're ripping them off and you're actually not. There's so many things like this, and it's the same when you're saying the granularity options when it comes to pricing on things like POCOs. It's just everything of this kind in Eve is just a little bit off. And the broker fees, where we got the double whammy, where it basically killed high frequency trading, not just in one go but in a double go. So you simply sacrificed price finding and slowed down the economy to a third. It's just bad. It's not good for the market. What they need is an actual, almost real life similar broker fee, right? Where the cost for a broker at downtown Manhattan is more expensive than one is in the ass end of nowhere. This is just how it should be. And that would also bring in a competition model for structures that players use. So then we have a way to compete on price with NPCs. This is always what CCP should do. Push players away from NPCs to actually participate in the game, have skin in the game, be part of the player versus player, not just pew pew die, but everything that's competition based. This is a competition based game. If you don't want to play a competition based game and you don't want to sink or give money to your fellow players, go play something else.
I mean, I would agree. If the game design creates the conflict and creates the competition, I would agree that the money is better off going to players instead of NPCs. It's just right now it creates a monopoly.
The question is, what do you define as conflict?
But it's important to remember, Omeka, it doesn't create the monopoly. The monopoly was created by players instead of conflict. And the monopoly that is existing still creates conflict in other places. Like, we're currently in the midst of a very large war. And I can assure you, every penny that all three sides are making is going into that war. You know, would we have even had the M2 Titan fights without the money that TTT had pushed into those groups? I don't know.
Let's just talk about the fact that in this room now is the PvP participants of HiSec structure. Willy literally killed my operations in HiSec. So I was the one that got ganked, and I'm not crying. So why are you people crying?
I'm not crying. I'm just saying that given the top 3, 4, 5 entities, like cutting them a free check and without any kind of worth, because we were talking about like maybe tens of trillions or maybe 100, without creating the equivalent amount of conflict, isn't worth it. If the conflict arises by game design, that's fine. If monopoly arises, I don't think players, like, I think the game pushes players to create the monopoly. So the game design is bad and it leads to monopoly. And
But that's the thing, though. Where do you think all the money for TTT is gone?
Yeah, but that argument can be made. Well, okay, let's just give people free ISK so they can fight, right?
But that's like, the thing.
You can make that argument for.
But you can't give people free ISK because that's not how it works, right? Like,
let's just give you three minerals so you can fight, right?
You
can make that argument for anything.
But that's not the argument that's being made.
You're clearly not participating in this type of gameplay, and you're assuming that the only thing in this game is ISK or muscle, and it's not. It's not been free for TTC to actually push out all the old competitors. That's not been free at all. It's not like they just rolled in and just said, fuck off, everyone, because there's always things like political costs, because the people that got pushed out have friends and money, and it will have consequences further down the line. Whether I'm going to push my money to try and hurt Willy in his backfield somehow, it doesn't mean that he's not going to pay. Right.
Let's look at Ignoitin right now. Right. Like, it's a very clear and simple example. The TTT took that money that it made, reinvested it into LowSec to provide services for its customers. So those customers utilized those services, but eventually a wolf came and destroyed those services. And, you know, in a different world, maybe we would have tried to defend them and been able to do so effectively. Questionable or doubtful, I don't know. But like to say that, you know, the money creates no conflict, that it doesn't do anything in the game is...
I'm not saying no conflict.
Very disingenuous,
I'm just saying no proportionate conflict. I'm just saying it's a lot of money that could have been used elsewhere to create even better conflict by better game design.
Well, what if the money that was...
All the money that sinks out to NPC creates zero content.
Well, no, send that to faction warfare, right? Each empire...
Yeah, you can send that elsewhere. They are reducing the faucets for a reason, right? So... there could be a bit more leeway to give more rewards to other people if you think that is nothing is free.
I would like to see Shop Galente, you know, because all the tax dollars that Galente Empire picks up go into a faction warfare fund that actually funds your reward system in faction warfare. That might be a little simple.
I just gave you guys the example of what would actually create some more meaningful competition, because I'm pretty sure that Willy will not chase me if I put a Sotillo 10 jumps away from perimeter and start doing T1 production for the Tech 2 production in the Sotillo in perimeter, which will make me a lot of money potentially, because the benefit of the low cost out there compared to the price that I can sell it for in perimeter is nice profit. That's how wealth redistribution works. But this is all down to CCP. And this whole thing of taking in a faucet and then pouring it out somewhere else instead of letting it work in players' hands is just dumb.
So if you ask me, I think what Caleb is suggesting, and what I asked Ratatti about, the dynamic broker fees, I think they're coming. So I'm going to bet my money that is coming. And I also think very soon they're going to alleviate some of the changes that they introduced a year ago with the broker changes. I think they're going to introduce some sort of way to reduce the costs for average for not large scale traders a little bit. I think that's what I'm reading out of Ratatti and the conversations that I've been having. And I think those two changes are coming. I don't have proof for that, but I do think that is very likely that we're going to see those changes this year.
Yeah, it's just important that they don't mess them up, right? Because everyone that knows a little bit about real life knows that the things that should be expensive would be things like office rental and services when you're in a centralized area. But the centralized areas should not be less efficient. The current design of something like the industry index is just dumb. Should be the other way around. Industry should be more efficient in the Sotillo in perimeter because of the economic activity and the industrial activity, not vice versa.
Yeah, which is rented.
They need to get these things right, because otherwise it's not beneficial. And then they need to have it so that structures should have consumption based on their activity. The fact that Willy has the same fuel as in perimeter as in the Keepstar in Ignoitin is just silly.
Yeah, we just rented an office in Willy's trade tower, and it was very reasonable. I must say it was a little too reasonable.
Reasonable?
Yeah, he only gave you a friendly rate, though.
Office rent in Gita is almost 2 billion. Let's just say let's remember that the perimeter Keepstar is number 2 in trade. It's actually number 1 if you look at only buy orders. So the economic activity in TTT is maybe not exactly on par, but it's getting close. It's about half the size of Gita. So the fact that we can buy an office at 25 million when it's almost 2 billion in Gita is like silly.
But don't raise your rent, Billy. That's not.
Yeah, you make me think I maybe should, but no, I'm not going to.
You could.
There's a lot of things that could be done, and yeah. I'm not going to lie here, guys. Like, I'm aware that the TTT and the way the system works now works to my advantage and my favor, and I'm also aware that the system is fundamentally not correct. But that does not necessarily mean that it is broken, if that makes sense. Like, the system needs adjustment. There is absolutely no doubt in my mind about that, and I think most players would agree. How to do that? I don't have the perfect answer. I think dynamic systems, dynamic fuel, dynamic, market orders, all of those are good, reasonable options. The answer is always the devil's in the details of how to make these things work. The TTT just aims to provide the service that is. There is one fountain for this ISK fountain, right? Like, there's a fountain there. It can either be like fought over like a mad scramble and where it's very difficult for traders to operate and it makes everybody's life harder, or one person can put a, you know, oil well or oil rig on top of that fountain and then, you know, divide the profits evenly among a number of different groups so that everybody shares and, you know, it distributes all that wealth outward. That's the system that I have worked towards creating. I understand everyone does not necessarily benefit from it, so they do not necessarily like it, but the answer is not perfect in terms of any real situation here. I don't want to be the villain in this situation.
It's your advantage.
You're not the villain. You're not the villain.
Hold on a second. If you lose this war and Goonswarm or the Imperium wins this war, they can pretty much throw you out of that, couldn't they?
So they could absolutely come and destroy the tower, but they could not hold the tower without the agreement. Right?
The
reality is
one of their own.
They could try, like, the reality is no block level group can truly hold the TTTC, like, of the three major powers currently. None of those three groups can hold the TTTC without at least a block level group there to defend it against another block.
Exactly.
Right? So it has to be all three groups, otherwise it doesn't work.
The last thing I want to say about all this is, really, we've been in the same CSM and we talked about conflict drivers a lot, and it was great. I learned a lot from a lot of you guys, goblins and you. It's just, forget about like TTT and citadels and everything. Imagine we're sitting in a CSM room and I'm offering like a conflict driver that's like a, say, oil well that needs to be held. And I'm saying...
we're like, talking about oil wells again. All that
yeah, kind of, yeah, yeah. Say it's an oil well. And I'm saying, like, by game design, this oil well will have to create a monopoly of four or five biggest organizations in the game, and they're going to share the value and no one else will get anything out of it. But it's
so the correct answer is,
but I'll argue that, you know, it's good for the game because they're going to fight use that money to fight elsewhere. But the money definitely goes to top however many people who can actually realistically hold the oil well, and it's going to be like that for years and years, and there's no fights are going to happen for a year or more. It's just we just want to give these top five entities money so they can fight elsewhere. Would you think that would be like a good proposal of a conflict driver?
No, of course not. But that the problem is, that's not what we have with the TTT. Is not, you know, how do I put this? Not the expected scenario to the changes that were made, right? When people put this stuff out, nobody was like, ah, one group is just going to, you know, do it, and then they're going to split it between the groups, and it'll turn into this kind of a situation. Everybody assumed there would be a significant amount of conflict over this stuff, but the problems with regionalization and some of the other problems that Caleb has talked about create this kind of optimal scenario if people can diplomatically manage to tolerate each other, I guess you would be the way to say it. So, and this is what you end up with, right?
Yeah.
So it creates a very odd dynamic.
But, you know, intentions don't matter, right? Whatever happens on the field, that's at the end of the day, that's what matters in ETH balance.
But the point
a lot of things happens out of...
You're ignoring the fact of who it is that's creating this. This is not nobodies. This is not even like a collusion of big industrials. We're talking about the biggest entities in the game has made this cartel. Every time this happens, it should be an effective monopoly. This is not a problem. It's a feature. It's a problem that is very difficult to put pressure points in there, but there should be the ability, especially when you can get three factions that are so different and really rarely would work together. But in this case, this is worth it. And it's happened before. It's
the OTEC cartel and Bombard Accords.
It should be possible. The question is there pressure points and points of failures that you can actually attack? In this case, sadly, there isn't. And unless
I completely disagree, by the way, there is absolute points of pressure you can attack. I'm just not going to talk about them on stream.
Well, this is literally the exact definition of the Malkanis law. People tell us like there is no way to help the little guy without buffing the big guy, and here we have a free check for five biggest guys or four biggest guys in the game, and nothing else for the other people. I'm just like. Categorically cutting a check to the biggest entities in the game for not much. Well, there's a lot of effort.
But here's the thing, Omeka. I made something for the small guys. I put a Tatara out there that literally decreased the average price of every ship in the game by like 2%, right? Like just little things, right? But, you know, did the little guy show up to help me defend against Snuff? No. Right, they didn't feel that was responsible, nor did they feel there was any benefit to it. Right,
you do.
It's important
you use
to
game design to achieve that. Like you don't create that situation. The game lets you to do that. Right, the game doesn't need to give you like trillions, hundreds of trillions.
He's not got any risk there. That that there's no skin in his game. He's literally fighting one of the entities that he's working with, and that's a massive liability. There's also the actual chance that something bigger than Snuff comes around. There's a massive liability. And if this thing falls, the whole ecosystem of player-run structure starts collapsing because this is actually propping it up. People trust player structures right now to a degree where out of the top 25, 19 in EVE is player-owned structures. That's how much we've taken market shares from the NPCs.
Yeah, it's normalizing.
But of those 19, how many of them are TTC or ICY?
Like, the majority.
Well, right.
That situation exists because the taxes are lower. Like,
but that's a circular argument because, of course, the people that you already trust will uphold the whole thing of not screwing you over are the structures that you're going to use. So they will see the majority of the market share. It's really about added value and trust, right? And that's what the TTC has brought.
It's, of course, it's, again,
part of the original structure owners that tried to do this, and we lost, and I'm accepting the loss. So the fact that you people keep whining really pisses me off.
Look.
Who's you people?
Look. What really disturbs me is that we are talking about like really providing or TTT providing a service and something. They did it out of some ingenuity or generosity or something. It's just the fact that taxes are lower in these structures pushes people there. If you want lower taxes, just lower them in Jita as well, right?
Okay, then that's your argument.
Please don't cut me. Please don't cut my word. If you want lower taxes, or I'll cut myself. if you want lower taxes, if your argument is just lower taxes, then let's just have them everywhere, right?
Hold on, Caleb. You got to let him talk.
But he's ignoring the fact that we used to have a limited amount of...
You're not letting him talk.
You had to build it with player structures, which was pauses. He's just omitting so much to the argument.
All right. Well, you can make that count. The rebuttal after he gets a chance to say something.
As a competition.
I mean, at least I don't call you dumb or something, or your ideas, or silly or something. I'm not being as aggressive as you.
Go ahead, I'm just making my point.
I'm not saying it's dumb. I'm just saying you're omitting it. You're simplifying the situation.
All right, Caleb. You're gonna give him a chance. Go ahead.
It's just really wasn't like a super creative person who provided all these services or cheaper prices to everyone. It's just by game design, the top entity, the top monopoly, the consortium, whatever, is able to do so. And at the other side of the things, it's not about trust. It's about just prices, right? Even I trade in TTT.
It really isn't, though.
Billy, please.
But when Mogul did this, it was the same thing. It was just a different business model. The whole thing is that you're criticizing business models that are based on player-to-player activity, which is complete bullshit.
Look.
But, okay, so Omeka, I'll just say something there. So like, you're saying that we don't provide anything different, right?
I'm saying that you are, but it's not your own creation. CCP gives you the ability. Like, it's like CCP, like, it's...
Do you think CCP planned out how the TTC was built?
No, but if you believe that taxes should be lower and then the services you provide are valuable to players, there is no reason why those services shouldn't exist or those situations shouldn't exist in NPC station as well. Why there is a difference between you and NPC stations? That's what I'm arguing against. I'm not arguing...
Because
not
nobody would use NPC stations if there wasn't an incentive to use player stations.
Well,
if you have the choice between NPC and player stations, you are always going to choose player stations. Always. Because it creates a situation where your assets are truly safe.
Omeka,
if you are going to take the leap to use a player station, you are incurring risk. You are putting your assets at the mercy of other players, both the holder of the structure, who are you placing your trust in, as well as your trust that that player can, or that owner can defend that structure against others, right? There is that, as well as the fact that when you say, you know, there's no plan.
But you're assuming there should be a reason to have player markets in HiSec. If player markets in HiSec they just cut money
absolutely,
to the top consortium in the game, then maybe there is no reason for
player markets. At one point, CCP decided they wanted markets to be something the players could do in HiSec.
If you want to fundamentally
challenge that assertion, that design goal, then sure, then maybe
that's,
they
that's
shouldn't.
I want to
challenge that design goal. Like, shouldn't there be more creative ways to, or more creative reasons than a price cut to build services?
Yes, that's what we've been saying, and that's what both Vili and I have agreed on. There's no doubt that there needs to be better ways to actually have competition, but competition should be between players. NPCs should be the least likely choice for you an option.
By the way, I fully agree. I fully agree with this.
We all agree on this one.
If they create competition in a more meaningful way that doesn't always arise a consortium, I'm with
marketing.
The players fighting, competing each other.
What if it sometimes arrives at a consortium, Omeka?
Well, then it's a matter of whether the money is worth the content, and clearly I don't see it worth. Maybe you do, and that's our disagreement,
like,
and that's why.
Omeka, what if different structures... Hold on a second. What if different structures had... like better delivery services, so you don't have to go to them to buy the stuff, but you would order it like in a electronic catalog and it would be delivered to you, and then different speeds or different distances, or you could compete on those kinds of things.
Now you're trying to do some sort of weird artificial price fixing. Human beings naturally aggregate like this. This is why we have the blue donut. This is why we have cartels. It's because when this is a benefit and there's nothing to stop you, that's what you do, because it maximizes your profit at minimal liability. This is just Econ 101, guys. The only thing that is different between EVE and real life is that in EVE, luckily, we don't have antitrust laws. We do have CCP that might actually intervene if it's completely bonkers. But fundamentally, this is why we have antitrust laws in the real world, because monopolies is the natural end point for all market stuff.
I don't know why the real life situation should be a game goal. I don't know if why
it's not a game goal. It's psychological.
Why like the wild capitalism should exist? Like, I mean, I don't know why like Eve should like. Do you want Eve to like create like these like a bunch of people and everyone stars and billionaires swim in billions? I mean, I don't know why Eve should approximate. If economics should approximate
real life. Literally what creates conflict. Literally what creates conflict. So I want all these things in my Eve. I don't want it in real life, but I definitely wanted it in Eve.
I can see by your eyes, you're like going to turn the camera.
Cutting checks to top organizations.
Cutting checks.
It doesn't create conflict, right? I mean, we all agree that there is something wrong with the system.
If you cut
you just
checks
want
to
better
mercenaries, it creates conflict.
You want better competition. I want better competition.
Yes.
We all want better game mechanics to create better PvP.
But they don't emphasize. Yeah. You were part of CSM. Billy's part of CSM. There are other people part of CSM. I don't know how many of you ever emphasized development that wasn't that was towards this kind of imaginative gameplay, having to do with markets, having to do with services, having to do with the miscellaneous and the ordinary in EVE Online. Because it just seems that CSM is always talking about conflict drivers in space for certain types of players that want to compete on a ship-to-ship level, not on an imagination level or ingenuity level of building interesting services. Actually, you know what we should do? We should build services, Caleb. What do you think? Well, based on a tranquility trade tower.
I'm a few steps ahead of you. I think we've already started a little bit of a group trying to do this. But again, this is back to the whole thing that I have actually played the market and financial game of EVE Online for 18 years now. I'm not talking out of my ass. I have seen these things happen in both directions,
wow,
right? Good and bad. And the point is, when you're talking about these exotic things and competition and stuff like that, it is so sensitive to what is possible in the game. If CCP makes the smallest change, it can topple over the entirety of what you're doing. And then usually it ends up in what is then deemed a scam or a Ponzi. But it usually didn't start out as a scam and a Ponzi. Most of these things are just burnout in EVE, just as much as in real life. And again, if ISK does not have any value, if it's not something that is something that people need and want, you can't sell it. That means you can't have a bank, because no one wants to fucking buy your money or do all that shenanigans that's required for stuff like that. So then it becomes the meta market version of the lull fights in NullSec, when it's like the whole already replaced, no one suffers any losses, right? It's the same problem. There needs to be some sort of volatility and scarcity, not famine. And there also needs to be occasional abundance, because abundance then topples things people that are trying to corner or manipulate the market to create artificial scarcity. So these things tie into each other. It's just that CCP has recently, or at least the last 6 years, not given a shit about all the other gameplays. It's only spaceships.
Okay. Omeka, you have anything else to add there on that?
I'm just going to skip that.
Okay, don't take the bait.
Caleb argued that monopoly creates competition. And there's so much in that in real life and EVE sense, but I'll just...
cartels. I mean, EVE Online as an imaginary world is kind of broken, right? Because you have a law that doesn't work in high sec. You have no system that you could take grievances towards. It's all military. And so people just behave with N+1, get your guns. We need to stack this place with people. You're seeing a war right now that is really... There's some incredible strategic things happening, but at the end of the day, it's 2-1. And that's winning the day for the most part. You have server conflicts that are the only real weather in the game. So the game isn't working as an imaginary world as well as it could. And I think this is a big area, high sec, finance, where they could add some interesting things that I don't think they want to touch, because they consider all this secondary gameplay pretty much. So
I think it's because they didn't know better. I'm actually not going to claim some sort of malice or blindness. I think it's just because they didn't think that these things mattered as much. I remember a very funny talk we had when in the structures roundtable, when maybe half the room was screaming that we needed to keep the starbase charters, because there still need to be some sort of tie-in and connection to PvE players when it comes to actually fueling structures. But because it was a little bit of a slash effort, I think, from the programmers, they decided to listen to the people that didn't want them or thought that they should just be removed because they don't serve any purpose. No, they might not serve a purpose for you, but they serve a massive purpose when it comes to people that need to convert LP, right? These things are, it's simplification in this whole quality of life creep, where they think they're doing a good thing and they don't understand that it just threw out a really good design.
Everybody cites 2011 as the best years of EVE Online, where they fixed everything and everything turned to ship balance and all that. And I think it was a disaster. I've always thought it was a disaster. It scars my imagination about EVE Online, because before that, there's a lot of promise. And then after that, it was like, okay, we'll give you 2 or 3 years to do your thing, but we want to go back to... what do you call them? Jesus features or some new ways to distinguish yourself. And what we got since then was a strange evolution that just kept moving in a certain direction. And you saw the...
Can we please stop calling TTC unassailable wealth? It's not.
It's your not wealth unassailable wealth.
Your wealth that's in Jeta 4.4, now that's unassailable wealth because you can't ever touch it or influence anything in there at all. You can't even change a little bit of a tick there. So that's unassailable wealth. What TTC is difficult to assail.
Fairly
definitely
assailable.
Not unassailable.
It is a diplomatically protected wealth.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
It's got, and that's what's cool about it.
It's terrible because the game design is just basically hard set towards diplomacy being the perfect solution, because PvPing at that scale in HiSec is just painful.
But thank you.
Diplomacy is gameplay. That is high-level gameplay.
Yes, but you shouldn't be forced into diplomacy because the combat is so bad.
The combat being bad is debatable.
Diplomacy being a solution because your opponents are extremely determined, or because you see like some gain that you can get out of something where there's opportunities for other people, maybe something like that. But the reason you lean towards diplomacy is because the gameplay sucks. Everyone who was actually in the large scale fights that took place over there was like, man, this is terrible.
I would argue
in
good.
Imagine yourself
it,
an M2 tech.
I hope it's
right?
Super boring and painful to do it. So you don't want to do it. And then you have competition among the people who will actually sacrifice to do it.
I would argue whoever can threaten the thing will already be invited into the competition. So that's the design.
That's actually a very good argument. But the point is that it's a matter of scales, right? What amount of wealth and cost should it actually have to try to take out a scale thing like the TTC, right? That should have a massive cost. That's equivalent to what people here sound like is that they want mom and pop shops to be able to take out Walmart. It's like, that's not how anything works in real life, or it shouldn't work, and it shouldn't work like that in Eve. It's just dumb. There's fundamentally nothing really wrong with TTC right now in the cartel business. It's just that there is really no way to even get a chunk of the crumbs right now. You can just get forced out with actual military force, and that's a mistake.
Look,
the largest groups don't fight over it because they can't motivate people to consistently fight over it, and they know that.
Well, let's do this.
I don't know about that, because all three of the groups that represent controlling parties have HiSec groups that pretty regularly PvP in HiSec over it. Like, they go kill Nashville, they do Wardex.
Pretty regularly is a very aggressive claim, seeing as there's been like two or three competitor Asvels that have died in the past like 3 months in the area.
You want to, because I'm pretty sure the Perimeter Police Department's killed three Asvels this week.
Billy, why is Ankar Watt still standing?
I believe that's the Darkness one, right?
I'm not sure. I haven't checked who owns it. It's in Periola.
If I had to take a guess, that's the Darkness one. It's positioned right on the edge of Losec, so Darkness can bridge right over. And for the most part, it just hasn't been worth the effort to take down, like, because it's got a strong military force behind it, and you know, they're going to come defend every time, and once we kill it, they'll just anchor a new one. And they're only siphoning off a couple billion isk worth of plex a month, so it's like, it's just, sure, go
look,
ahead.
Okay, let me bring you back.
Can I just point out the amount of content that was created when the cartel fell last time, right? And it's the same risk that's in the TTC, right? And it just keeps growing.
I think the problem, though, and this, hold on a second, hold on, Murray, hold on a second. We're going to wrap up in 4 minutes anyway, and I'll give you a chance to talk. But there's the problem that people are having is that these powers that go out to NullSec and grow big and strong then get together and take all the money out of HiSec, because they're the only ones that can compete in this space, and they kill everybody who competes with them. And I think the way to keep the money for HiSec people is to not necessarily destroy the building, but find a way to symbiotically live with it and make your own cut of the profits. Find ways to create services inside those structures that take away from just the purchasing power that it has, And that could be any number of things, like renting ships out to players who are going to be buying these skill packs or anything. But I think somehow there can be a way to make money underneath these big structures that you don't have the power to kill and keep the money inside of HiSec. Go ahead, Murray. I saw that sour face, by the way, Caleb. You'll have to clean that up for me. I made a mess of it.
Well, I'm just cybering it. It's just it really frustrates me that people seem to have this weird angle on this game design, because fundamentally structures and moon mining is some of the most amazing designs that CCP has added to the game. They're still a little bit unbalanced, but the potential and even the improvement from these things is mind-blowing, and I just get frustrated when I hear people complain about them.
I think another key component, which Manorol, I think you don't even mention there at all, is that the vast majority of the money that's like being generated and being talked about here isn't because there's all this big potential for this market for, you know, industry and trading of modules and ship production and all of those little things that we talk about when we mean industry. Now, hundreds and hundreds of billions of ISK that go through every month from that citadel come from Plex and large skill injectors. Plex, which you need if you're going to Plex alts to play this game, in a game where alts are practically required in many situations. And to me, I don't even care who necessarily has it. I don't think that any groups should be making hundreds of billions of ISK from the items that people like need to play the game at that very base level.
Even like they don't. It's not even the PvP. Like if you can threaten the structure, you're gonna get invited into the consortium. And imagine like so. It's like by definition, like there's nothing different from this than a game design where CCP just selects, let's select like 10 biggest alliance and give them money so they can fight. Like give them money monthly so like they can
pay their
create
FCs.
Content or whatever. Because the game design is just like in a way that you're, because if you fight over it, the money is not generated. So if you keep like, if conflict happens over it, there is no profits to be made, right? Because nobody will trust into the in the structure anymore. I won't hold my Plex and items in there because in a structure that's likely to die or that dies regularly. So
yeah, about 75% of the trade is security and dependent, right?
So what we saw from
when we took over the tower to the current day is about a 400% growth in trade.
Yeah. So
is spread over a variety of items, right? But
so the by far best move you can do is if anyone can threaten it, just let's just share the profits, right? And then this game, this design, turns into a design where just let's select the most powerful few alliance in the game and give them money. In my eye, anyway.
No, so, but it's important to remember, it's not just the most powerful alliances, right? It's as you said multiple times, it's anybody that can threaten the structures is also usually given a hello, how you doing? Because if the wealth is not shared, the wealth is eventually lost, right?
Yeah, so by power, just assume that I mean anyone that we can. So there's a threshold, right? Let's give everyone
right. But what you're money. Saying is that it needs to be, the wealth needs to be shared based on what? Because it's currently shared based on military power.
Right now, I don't think this fountain should exist. I don't think like this is not a good way to provide people money.
What part of the fountain? The Plex or the trade part?
CCP changed it so that any taxes from the sale or trade of Plex or injectors went solely to CCP and left everything else as is, the TTT would not be an issue. It would still make money, but it wouldn't be at such a scale that when shared, it was still amounts that put all of the groups that basically managed to scrap, like ram enough F1 monkeys into a single area to basically get their cut, this advantage over everyone else in the game.
I don't think you realize how much non-Plex trade goes through the towers. Like, Plex trade is not, you know...
If you want to release a nice little spreadsheet that shows all the numbers, be my guest. Until then, I'm going to work with the numbers that are publicly available that show me that a huge portion of that income is coming from Plex and injectors.
Sure.
It used to be that way. I don't think it's that way anymore. It takes a while, though, for that to grow. People grow trust in a structure... Once it's been there for a while, and they start to do other things in it. If you look, Perimeter Trade Tower has a lot of different merchandise on there. But I agree with you, when it was done before, it was pretty much RMT materials, which are injectors and especially Plex.
Well, back when it was the Fortizar system before the tower went up, it was entirely Plex related, right? Because that was the only item which you could realistic, like you had Plex vaults back then, so you could, it was okay if the structure died and you were just concerned with your very, very short term profit in terms of your trade situation.
Yeah. When I've been buying moon goo and compressed ore and on my perimeter alt recently, I've seen much more of it being sold in the Keepstar rather than Cheetah 4-4 recently.
Yeah. And well, we have full, I wouldn't say we have full control, but we have all of the lower value, higher density industrial material is significantly higher traded through the TTT than JITA. Like minerals like titanium, pyrite, that kind of stuff, TTT. When you get into the smaller stuff like Zydrine Megasite, it's much more JITA heavy because people are still comfortable bringing DSTs and such through the gates, I guess. I'm not sure exactly why. And usually what you see is the people who want to buy these materials to go take them to produce with them usually prefer to buy a TT, and our trade volume is significantly higher on those materials than JITA. Because nobody wants to add in the extra step of going into JITA and then going out of JITA with those materials.
Yeah, I just go with whichever is I can get it cheaper in.
I was just going to give a real-world example as well when we're talking about monopolies. I mean... if you consider companies like Apple, Google, and Facebook, if you create a technology company that could even potentially begin to rival them, they will buy you out immediately and assimilate you. I mean, Apple buys a company easily once every 3 weeks. So I don't think it's that far from the real world to say that if a military power becomes big enough to be a threat to the TTT, they will be assimilated into the TTT program. I mean, that happens in real life with companies... you know, regularly.
Sure.
Well, I mean, it's very obvious, you know, as the leaked, or I leaked the snuff conversation regarding our agreement, right? And I think everyone is well aware that snuff is not the only person that the TTT pays for additional security assistance and to remove, how would you put it?
Them as a potential threat in the future.
Yeah, possibly. Exactly, right? Yeah. The building of rebel ties, I guess you could say, or something. And, you know, that's just the way it is. I'm doing what I can to continue to provide a stable and secure facility, and I understand people may not like the methods, but they are what they are.
Just a humble man.
He blames you and your choices. You blame the mechanics that make such of a situation both possible and the optimal solution.
But those mechanics are always going to be possible, right? It's human nature to want security and safety. It's not like it's some crazy thing where people are like, well, I'd much rather trade over at this, you know, structure that's likely going to be dead in 2 weeks. They're going to choose the one that's...
I don't get this argument from human nature. Why are we fighting in this game? If the human nature, like, why aren't we just... like
competition is human nature, Omeka. I can assure you that
one. No, cooperation is human nature, it turns out.
But you just argued... cooperation, like you just argued, like coming together and like creating this consortium is human nature, right?
I think you need a history book or two.
I mean, I just think like moving from IRL or human nature is just useless, because you could argue human nature is competition, you could argue human nature is cooperation. It's just what we need is a game that fosters conflict.
I'm saying is that people are going to take whatever game you give them, and they are going to adapt their psychological patterns into that game. That is why you have.
As a game designer, you take that into account, and you take you operate within that factor. The reason you don't see fighting at the TTT, I was in test when that fighting went down. Everyone hated it because it's the same tie-dye, the same. module in and like unresponsiveness that you get in M2, except instead of killing Titans, which is, you know, kind of cool, you're killing Feroxes, which you can do literally anywhere in the game, and you can do in not Titans.
Consider boredom a byproduct.
It's inherently unfun, unpleasant for everyone involved, and as a result, there's this massive drive to ensure that as little fighting on that scale ever occurs, because you know that your members will burn out, your FCs will burn out, and you don't want to be there anyway. And that's the problem that drives all of that diplomacy, all of that effort to ensure that non-competitiveness. Like, yes, stability gets you a little more money, but at the end of the day, particularly at the start, it was about securing that Plex market and not having to suffer through that mechanic.
See, I don't think everything comes down to joy of having muscle,
right. It's the fact that actual goons or mobsters and wise guys can basically go into Wall Street or big banks or big Walmarts and actually do the same type of racketeering that they can with a mom and pop shop. That's silly. That is a problem. And I don't think that that should be possible at all. I think it's the whole war mechanic is just ridiculous in HiSec. I think the competition between structures in HiSec should fundamentally be based on actual financial and market-related things.
All they did with that war mechanic was balance it for combat. Like, it's not balanced for like any kind of reality in the universe. It doesn't make any sense. I won't go.
I think there's actually a much better question. I think Sawyer in chat just asked a perfect question for you, Murray. What if you own the TT? What would you do different?
Do anything different. And that's the problem.
Okay, so
you're running the optimal solution based on the game mechanics available, which isn't like shows that the problem is the mechanics themselves, not the people involved. But that's
so what, right? What mechanical change would you make?
There's a couple of options. I don't claim to have all the data to tell you which one is best because I do not work at CCP.
You just kill the offshoring, and I think you'll...
Yeah.
Option one is changing the way the taxes are set up so that you can actually undercut again, because a huge disincentive to doing any sort of competitive action right now is there's no way to actually undercut the TTT. At best, you can do the same. So you can't offer a riskier, cheaper alternative, since the TTT is set at the minimum market rate. Another one is the question of why there's a Keepstar in HiSec at all. Why Empire would allow Keepstar.
You can't go back. You can't turn the clock back on the Keepstar in HiSec thing. As much as I agree with your assessment there, like that would... I understand I'm the one arguing this position, so it doesn't...
I understand why you say that, and I agree, and I don't think that would be my first choice, but it is a thing. The third is the option I mentioned before, removing the tax return that players get whenever Plex or injectors are traded in their citadels. I don't know the exact numbers, but my suspicion is that cuts the numbers down to a much more reasonable trade out in terms of ISK made by various partners in the TTT compared to the amount of PvP content that the TTT generates.
By the way, Brisk is out there. This is an open forum. It's open to public if you guys want to come in. It's an open discussion, so you're welcome to come in. Anybody.
Just kill the offshoring and then find other ways for people.
So what do you mean by offshoring?
By the tax difference between NPC and...
Okay, so you say kill the tax difference between NPC in structures, but...
And then find other ways to make markets slightly meaningful or create... Like to emphasize conflict between markets, and then
taxes so that running a manufacturing citadel could actually be a profitable venture in terms of like getting people to build there, versus like you've admitted this, like the industry taxes, which everyone knows make almost no money. The money comes from when people are trading in those citadels or trading in
the correct. Like I run the most active sodio in the game, and it makes literally nothing. Like, you know,
that's a very easy way to make player citadels still something that would be relevant, but not necessarily with them making all their money from the market side.
And by the way, you guys all have your regional markets, which you already generate a lot of money. So the market gameplay is available to you in NullSec, and you provide a lot of value there because the location is yours, and the only place I can trade in that location is your citadel. So I will do that, and you'll earn your alliance taxes and everything. So this is just additive, free check, free money for biggest consortium in the game. So when you ask what would you do, it's like it's assuming the thing is beneficial and can be improved. But if I'm arguing that it's just not necessary, even for this money.
Well, what you're saying is you want to take something out, which in this case you say you want to take out the tax difference between
and
NPC
then give
and
it to, yeah, take that income from you and give it to low-sec people, give it to other people who need it. Because in my book, every ISK in the game that's generated and sunk is related to each other.
But then I'm just going to go to low-sec and take their fucking pie. Like, it doesn't.
Like, if that creates conflict, do that, because this doesn't.
This is envy socialism, and it's bullshit. Right.
It's not socialism.
Man after my own heart.
Redistribution.
This game is about.
Capitalism. It kills conflict. The Amazons, the Facebooks. We have five big companies in the world. Big companies in the world that kill stifles all the other competition. You guys talk about competition, talk about PvP, talk about conflict. This is a PvP game, right? And then you argue for big consortiums of and the situation of no competition and no PvP, and you think that you argue that it's good.
You're talking about CCP doing wealth distribution. That's
I'm not talking about wealth distribution.
Saying,
CCP
saying,
is already CCP is already giving
solution.
Money.
State
CCP,
solutions should be
no.
One at a time.
CCP, I'm talking about. CCP is handing out money to TTT. I'm not talking about taking from the rich and giving to people. I'm talking about stop handing over money to billionaires. Right?
You did just say that. You said that and the ISK sunk out should be paid out to the poor.
Yeah,
literally socialism,
like,
you argue.
No,
and,
no.
And I'm fine
no,
with that in real life. You
stop
just shouldn't put it in
no.
my
one
game.
At a time.
It's
so
definitely
we can
not
this.
Socialism. I'm like, it's giving it's money to billionaires. I'm selling, I'm saying, look, let's not give.
It?
Wait,
look,
one at a time.
It. Yes.
Right. I'm going to start
force.
Muting you guys so you guys can talk one at a time.
CCP is giving money to free money to
No, they're not.
They are
taking it with force. That's competition. That's
CCP
the whole
by game design giving free
no.
money to the biggest consortium in the game by
no,
game
no, the,
design.
The biggest dog will always win. It's just
yes.
how big is the dog and how many are participating in
it. Doesn't,
it
doesn't CCP doesn't okay,
the
then why don't CCP just give like 10 biggest alliances 10 trillion in the game a month?
Okay.
Right.
I was being quiet. I was being quiet while you were ranting. Could I please be allowed to have a few seconds where I?
You got to ask me, and the answer is no. You can't.
Everything you
and he wasn't ranting.
Said,
he was talking. So
and,
we got to wrap
and I was
it up.
Waiting until he completely.
No, you weren't
went
waiting. You
the,
were all over him, like I'm all over you right now. Like you were all over him.
You
guys are all over each other. So this is what we'll do.
I've literally been muted for a few minutes.
I had
because you were all over.
This is what we'll do, Caleb. Go ahead, get your point out, Omeka. You can rebuttal, and then we're gonna bring this to an end. Go ahead.
Everything he basically has been saying is basically bringing in some sort of CCP control socialism, where people should get stuff from CCP and rich people should not be able to get rich. That's all I've heard. He's basically saying that Vili is getting this for free from CCP from game design. Trust me, it's not been free. It's not free at all. There's massive liabilities. There's huge risk. There's skin in the game. This is what everything EVE is about. I've said this already. Sure, there are aspects of what people have been saying that I kind of agree with. And in my end level, it should be practically impossible to use this monopoly of force in a policed area that's supposed to be civil, right? And the other one is, eventually, I would also remove all RMT items, so Plex and stuff like that. But I want all the other stuff to be only on player structures. I want all other stuff than RMT to be on the TTC and other structures like that, because it needs to be me fighting Vili, not Vili fighting CCP.
Got it. Okay, Omeka, your rebuttal on that.
this is not at all about socialism. It's more about let's not give billions to billionaires. Because there's you say there is risk. I think there's maybe like 100 or 50 trillion that's money being made. And as opposed to that, like maybe there's 1 trillion investment that's at risk, or maybe it's just a kickstart and maybe organization. Okay, there is some level of organization, but it's not at the level where it deserves hundreds of trillions of CCP sink going to this place that creates no conflict and that invites everyone who can threaten it into the consortium. So it's not about like let's take from the rich and give from the poor. It's more about, look, why are we giving the rich even more money instead of we're distributing them in a way that creates fun in the game, actual fun and conflict and explosions.
What you don't understand, what you really don't understand is the fact that the day that really can't use actual fleets in HiSec to crush someone like me, and the day that the Plex moves to CCP, so you can't only live by that single item type monopoly and compete on endless bottom prices, there is no way that he's going to be able to keep a monopoly, because it's not going to be possible, because there's going to be people like myself that will be able to actually get in there and do structures in a meaningful way. And then it becomes a competition on who can provide the best services, who can actually do the number crunching better, who's got the most industrialist contacts, who's got the most money. Then it's no longer the whole cartel dominating everything.
Sure,
then you get everyone is capable of getting in. Of course, the barrier of entry is high to compete with someone like Willy. You need trillions, but I can definitely gather people around me that will have enough trillions to compete with that, at least if it's no longer the three biggest entities.
So far, the competition didn't happen. If there's a better game design, which can arise the competition and conflict, I'm all for it. I've been all for it for this conversation. It just didn't happen. If it didn't happen, I don't see why CCP keeps giving more and more money to this thing. If there's a better game design, please CCP do it. If there is not a better game design yet, then there is no reason for this handout to keep happening again and again every month.
Yeah. I just think it's not given enough of a priority. They're kind of just leaving it there. And that's unfortunate. There's not enough imagination goes into it. I think they don't want to touch it. They consider it secondary gameplay. It just supports the primary gameplay in their opinion. But a lot of us are here and a lot of publicity comes out of the secondary gameplay. I mean, how many stories have you heard about the market? You see the CEO of CCP, Hilmar, talking about the intricacies of the market. Not much attention is given to the market. And this kind of stuff, you know, I like the idea that diplomacy has a big role to play. That's really what's holding this whole thing together. But diplomacy depends on all that strength behind it, which means only an exclusive group of people can do something like the Tranquility Trade Tower. So
yeah, then it's a gang war. And that's fine in the outskirts where there might not be as much law and order. Of course, you should have gangster-like business. That's fine. I love that. I'm a huge fan.
Outlaw
I just
space.
Don't think that, not just the outlaw space, but when you're talking about space that's a little bit further from the trade hubs, I'm just saying that the civilized space that's supposed to be the main streets of a city where all the big companies and the lawyer firms and the banks and the stock exchanges are, you shouldn't have mobsters strong-arming bankers. It just doesn't make sense. The point is that I'm saying those type of big boys play, right, should not be handled with demolition teams. It should be handled with bankruptcy teams, right? You make your opponent go bankrupt, just like, well, actually the Goon Cabal made my IPO investment fund go bankrupt because they kept crushing me on the market. That's
PvP.
The type of market PvP, these things are an actual thing in this game. I know that many people have not actually looked into it, but it's really fun when you do it. And I would love to compete with something like TTC without it being based on who's got the most fighter pilots.
And last word on this, I think the Keepstars, the skyscrapers, should be downtown. They shouldn't be in Farmville, USA, right? Like, I'm from a rural area where I grew up, and we didn't have a skyscraper in the middle of fields. Like, that's not what you have. You got to go to a city where the resources are, where the people are. That's where you build your big buildings. So keep star in Empire Space makes total sense. That's it. We're way over. Thank you guys for coming around. Thanks for watching us. I want to thank especially Olmeca for visiting us again. My friend.
No, thanks for having me.
It's always a pleasure. You're always welcome. Caleb, Billy, all the guys that were here earlier. And of course, Oz for putting together the interview with CCP that gave us this reaction stream. That was a lot of fun. Thank you guys for watching. And there won't be talking in stations today for the day. We'll just rerun this, maybe take some excerpts and put that up today. And then we'll see you again tomorrow on Talking in Stations. Bye, guys.